We are grateful to be in your house, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Come on, will you stand with us tonight as we praise him?
Oh,
different here tonight. We have a special guest with us, and that's Sumter First Drama Team. We would love for them to come up. We are so honored that they're going to be ministering for us tonight. So you can, if you will, please be seated, and they are going to be ministering to us. Before we do that, I'd like for, while they're getting everything set up, if you are from a different church, if you're not from Lake City PH Church, will you stand up for me? You're not from Lake City PH. We are so, so honored that all of you guys came out. Give them a good hand clap. We're glad to have our home people here too, but it's just wonderful to have all of you with us, and we're honored to have you here. And we're excited to see Sumter First minister for us tonight.
Hey guys, a little sick. God is good, isn't he? So what you're about to see tonight, it's just been laid on so many of our hearts, and it has truly been a godsend to us, to change our lives. I'm really hoping it'll change your lives, and just, you know, whatever you came in here tonight, whatever burden, whatever mountain, whatever sickness, whatever pain, anything, just know that God can take all of that away with one word, all of it.
Thank you, God.
And just notice to who you're going to see, because you never know who's in the midst of you.
I see a shadow.
Made me wild. My
Amen. Can we give the Lord another shout of praise in here? What a powerful drama that was. That is incredible. The testimonies of the things our God has done in people's lives. All of us could stand up in here today and have one of those signs and say, this is what Jesus did for me. This is how God ministered to me. And that's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Sumter First, for blessing us. We are truly grateful. Amen. So good to see Trey and Dana back as well. We're so thankful for the work that God is doing in their lives and in the ministry. Well, now it is time. We're going to go ahead and do our tithes and offering, or our offering. And all of the offering is going to bless our evangelist. We love Pastor Anthony and his wife, and they are family. And we really want them to have the funds to go out and minister everywhere they possibly can. So please give generously whatever God has placed on your heart. I know God has placed something on my heart. Please give. And if our ushers would come up and stand at the front, I want us to stand up and come give. Somehow it just helps us to give better when we have to walk and actually give it. So if you'll stand to your feet and get your offering in your hand, we're going to pray over it, and you can come and put it in one of these offering baskets. Jesus, right now, we ask that you help us to be obedient. God, we pray over the ministry of Pastor Anthony Cole and over Miss Teresa. We ask that you bless them abundantly. Show favor everywhere that they go. Let the windows of heaven open up for them, and let them be able to carry the gospel into places they never imagined. God, we thank you for what you're going to do in them, and allow us to be a part. Allow us to be a part right now and give obediently. And we love you. And it'll give you all the glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord.
Come on and lift it up. Every praise is to our
Every praise is to our God. the eyes of men, it seems there's so much we have lost. As we walk down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves.
Come alive.
Come alive. was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus
atmosphere up. Y'all just keep praying. The Lord can do more in just a few seconds than we can do in a lifetime. Amen. I think we ought to just lift our hands and just begin to praise Him.
Sing hallelujah.
We praise you, Lord God. Father God, that you are inviting us and constantly inviting us to an altar, Lord God, to where we can be renewed, refreshed, and restored in you, Christ Jesus. Father, I thank you right now, Lord Jesus, for your anointing, Lord God, that is in this place tonight, Lord God. Father God, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you've given us the ability to come in this place tonight, Lord God, and shut down all the operations of hell and to release heaven on earth, Lord God. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your spirit and your anointing in this place tonight, Lord God, that destroys the yoke, Lord God, and lifts the burden off of people's lives, Lord God. Father God, that we're therefore now, because we are Christians, because we are in you, Lord God, there's therefore now no condemnation to those who walk upright before you, Lord God, who do not walk according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit, Lord Jesus. And Father, we praise you and we thank you right now, Lord God, for your deliverance, your help, Lord God, and your strength. Hallelujah. Your anointing, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Yes, Father. Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 We praise you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Lord God. Nothing that you're facing tonight. That God can't help you with. There's no deliverance that you need that He can't deliver you from. Amen. There's no state that you're in that He can't help you through. He's that kind of a God. He's a big God. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a hand. Yes, Father. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You could be seated if you can. I want us to be sensitive to the Spirit. know about you, but I can't make it without him. I need his spirit. And I got news for you. If you don't know it or not, you do too. We all do. Our families deserve it. Our church deserves it. Our city deserves it. Our neighborhoods deserve it. Oh, you think you just living in a neighborhood just to be there? Not a chance. God's placed you there to be a light in that place, to be a witness. Amen. How many of you remember the story of David when David came into Jerusalem, took Jerusalem over, began to build a house? The Lord built him a house, established him, and David desired to build the Lord a house. And one day David called Nathan. Nathan came to him, the prophet. David was sharing with him. He said, "I desire to build the Lord a house." And Nathan told him, he said, "You go and do what's in your heart, for the Lord is with you." And Nathan went and prayed. And a little while he'd come back, he said, "You can't do this, David. It's not for you to do. But your son will." And the Lord began to share with David and give David all the plans that come about to build the temple. He wasn't able to build the temple, but he gave him the plans to build the temple. He placed that in his heart. But Solomon prayed a prayer. When he bought the temple was brought into fruition. David gave Solomon all the plans. He laid out all the plans that were supposed to be there for the temple. Let me just tell you this. God has left us all the instructions that we need to build the house of God. But Solomon prayed a prayer, and I want you to listen to this. And I want you to say this with me. After I say it, because it's going to take a little while to get this. Solomon prayed a prayer for the prayers that when they prayed, their prayer would be heard. Y'all say that with me? Solomon prayed a prayer for the prayers that when they prayed, their prayers would be heard. Solomon prayed a prophetic prayer over the nation of Israel. A lot of times we quote scripture and we just say things and not really know where it derives from. But as Solomon prayed this prayer, in 2 Chronicles 6 and verse 12, it says, "Then Solomon stood before the altar in the presence of the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands." He humbled himself. He got on the altar. He spread out his hands. He says, "And may you hear the supplication," in verse 21, "of your servant and of your people Israel. And when they pray toward this place, hear from heaven your dwelling place. And when you hear, forgive." Solomon was saying, when the people pray a prayer, I want you to hear what they pray. And when they pray their prayer, I want you to forgive them of their sins. Then he said, "If anyone sins against his neighbor and he is forced to take an oath and comes and takes the oath before the altar of this temple, then hear from heaven and act and judge your servants, bringing retribution on the wicked and bring his way on his own head, and justify the righteous by giving him according to his righteousness." And what he was saying is, when those that have been forgiven have failed and they come back to you, forgive them and justify them. And then he says, or if your people, Israel, are defeated before an enemy because they have sinned against you and returned and confess your name and pray and make supplication for you in this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive their sin, the people of Israel, and bring them back to the land which you gave them and their fathers. Solomon prayed a prayer that when the prayers prayed, that their prayer would be heard in that place and that God would have mercy on them. How many of you know that we need mercy? How many of you know that this nation needs mercy? We need the mercy of God on this nation. I want to just say this. Some of the things that are happening in our nation right now and around the world are not normal events, folks. These are spiritual events. There's very dark wickedness in this nation and around the world. I still believe we live in the greatest nation on planet Earth. I believe that. But we're living in a very dark age, and we need to be aware of it. Saints of God, we need to get equipped with the power and the presence of God in our lives. I'm not telling you to go out and look for wickedness. You don't have to look for it. It'll be there. It'll find you. But you need to be prepared to be able to handle it when it comes your way. And if we're not, we're going to be in trouble. Because in this last day, you're going to see people who are going to come into this place and other places who need deliverance. And if we're not prepared to take care of it, we need to be connected to a God that hears us when we pray. We need to understand that we're not just going through the motions here. We're not just coming to church. I'm not just preaching a message to make you feel good. I'm hoping that something that I say this week or something that has been said in the services are going to get you to a place to where you build a relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that when you pray the prayer that you pray in this place, that He will hear what you are saying and have mercy on His people, that He will forgive, that He will justify, and that He will have mercy on His people. Because we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. When we come to the place to where we think that we have arrived because we belong to a certain church, that's where we have messed up. It doesn't matter if you belong to the Baptist church. It doesn't matter if you belong to the Methodist church. It doesn't matter even if you belong to the Pentecostal church. What matters is you better belong to God, and you better have His name on your heart and on your life. You better have a relationship with Him that when you, listen, God don't need people to just call Him in a 911 situation. You better have Him on the line. You better have Him on, not just on speed dial. You better be able to be talking to Him when the need comes. I don't need to be trying to get Jesus on the main line. I need to be on the main line with Jesus. I need to be connected to Him. So Solomon prayed a prayer for the prayers that when they prayed that their prayers might be heard. And he said, and when heaven is shut up and there is no rain because there is sin against you, and when they prayed towards this place confessing your name and turn from their sin because you afflict them, then hear from heaven and forgive their sin and your servants, your people Israel, that you may teach them the good way in which they should walk, and send rain on your land, which you have forgiven, which you have given to your people as an inheritance. He's saying, when your people come to a place to where they have turned their back on you and they realize it and everything has dried up around them, I'm asking you that you hear their prayers when they turn back to you, and that you revive them by sending rain, by sending an anointing, by sending your power, by opening up the floodgates and pouring out your spirit in their midst. revive them. If you find yourself in a position to where you are dry and you're weary and going through things, listen to me, folks. It does not mean that you have backslidden, but sometimes we find ourselves there because of the decisions that we make. We make bad decisions and we want to blame it on everybody else. We don't do the right things. We do the things that we don't do the things that we know to do, and we don't do the things that we know that we shouldn't do, and we just continue on going through the motions. But God has called us to be a people that walks after Him and walks after His Spirit, that looks to Him, that is led by His Spirit day by day. But so many of us look at the circumstances around us. We look at the mountains. We look at everything that we're facing, and we measure ourselves up to that. Get your eyes off of the circumstance and look to the God that you serve, and know that He's bigger, He's better, He's badder, and He can take care of it. And be one who prays a prayer that when you pray, your prayer is heard because of Him. And He will revive you. I ask myself two questions all the time, constantly. These are the two questions I ask myself. Am I where I'm supposed to be? And am I doing what God told me to do? I have to keep myself in check all the time. Because if I'm not where He told me to be and I'm not doing what He told me to do, then I'm not going to see the blessings of God. Period. You say, well, you don't know what kind of dry season I'm in. It doesn't matter if you're in a dry season. God's not bound to seasons. God don't need rain to give you a harvest. He's God all by Himself. And if you're where He told you to be and you're doing what He told you to do, then He's going to show up to you in a way that you've never seen Him before. And He's going to take care of the situation. But we got to understand something. We cannot sin and get away with it. We've got a generation that's coming up right now in this world . They want to do things like the world. They want to act like the world. They want to dress like the world because they think that's cool. Because why? Because the same statistics is in the church that is in the world. How's that going to change when the church becomes the church? It's not the world's fault. Come on now, y'all getting quiet on me tonight. See, I think it would do us a lot of good if we put on a shock collar like we use on them. You know, we put on them dogs and let them out in the yard. They may run to a certain place at one time, but when they get there and get shocked the first time, you know, it don't take but a couple of times, they learn not to go there anymore. There's a boundary. What's wrong with folks in the church is we've not set up boundaries. We want to walk in sin and still have the blessings of God. It's not going to happen, folks. You got to separate yourself from sin. Nowhere in the Bible, nowhere in the Bible can you find and show me that if you ask for forgiveness of your sins that you'll be saved. If you repent. If you repent and turn from your sin. It's not about just asking for forgiveness. You got to make up your mind you're going to turn from it. Why? Because God requires holiness. The enemy wants to keep us divided. But God wants to bring holiness to his body so the gifts of the Spirit can flow through his people. So that when we pray a prayer, it's heard. Amen? Hallelujah. It says, and when there's famine in the land, pestilence and blight, mildew, locust and grasshoppers, and the enemy besieges them in the land of their cities, whatsoever plague or whatever sickness there is, whatever prayer, whatever supplication is made by anyone or by all your people, Israel, when each one knows his own burden and his own grief and spreads out his hands to this temple, then hear from heaven the dwelling place and forgive, and give everyone according to his ways, whose heart you know, for you alone know the hearts of the sons of men, that they may fear you and walk in your ways as long as they live in the land which you gave them to our fathers. What he was saying, when they pray a prayer in this place, I want you to hear their prayer and I want you to heal them. There's a lot of people that's in the church today who need healing. They need healing of their past. We bring people in. We get people in church and get them involved in church, not seeing the brokenness in their lives. They need inner healing. Some people have been hurt very badly in relationships and different things like that. There needs to be healing where they can move on. Because if healing doesn't take place in their life, what's going to happen is there's going to set in a root of bitterness. And when bitterness sets in, everything goes wrong. It's hard to recover from bitterness. He said, moreover, concerning the foreigner who is not of your people, Israel, but has come from a far country to take for the sake of your great name and your mighty hand and your outstretched arm. When they come and pray in this temple, then hear from heaven your dwelling place and do according to all which your foreigner calls to you and to the people of the earth, that they may know your name and fear you as do your people Israel, and that they may know that this temple which I have built is called by your name. What he was saying is when people come in who don't know you and who have not known you, who is a foreigner to you, and they come in and they begin to pray to you, reveal yourself to them. How many of you know that we need God to reveal himself to folks today? You're the key through which God will reveal himself to people. We're the key. It's up to us to have enough of Jesus in us that they see a difference in us and that God can reveal himself through us. We need to be able to come into a place and set an atmosphere such as was set here tonight, to where the Spirit of God begins to move in the hearts and the lives of the people, where people can be fixed in their seats. All it takes is one touch of the presence of God. Countless of testimonies all over the world now. More people, more Muslims are being saved and set free because they have testimony of Jesus just showing up to them and revealing himself to them. That's the kind of anointing that we need. We need an anointing that's going to bring the power and the Spirit of God down into this place, down into this area, down into Lake City, to where there's such an anointing, to where Jesus is revealed to this community. He says, and when your people go out to battle against their enemies wherever you send them. And when they pray to you towards this city which you have chosen, and the temple which I have built in your name, then hear from heaven and pray supplication and maintain their cause. When they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin, and you come and you become angry with them and deliver them into the enemy, and they take them as captives to the land far near. Yet when they come to themselves in the land where they were carried captive and repent and make supplication, you in the land and their captivity say, we have sinned and have done wrong and have committed wickedness. And when they return to you with their hearts and with all their souls in the land of their captivity, where they have been carried captive, and pray towards their land which you gave to their fathers, the city which you have chosen, and toward the temple which I have built for your name, then hear from heaven your dwelling place, their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause, and forgive for your people who have sinned against you. Restore them. He said, when they come to you and they've been carried off to a foreign land, when they find themselves, when they come to their senses, what are you talking about? He's talking about the backslider. He's talking about those who have turned and found other gods and turned to other gods and went off for a while. But when they come to their senses, he said, when they pray the prayer, I'm praying that when the prayer of the prayer is heard and they repent, they come back to you, Lord, that you'll restore them. You'll bring restoration to them. And all this comes to the answer of the prayer that God, after all of this that Solomon said, and he prayed those prayers. And we all know this because we quote it all the time. God spoke to Solomon, and he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer made in this place. For now I have chosen and sacrificed this house that my name may be sanctified, this house that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. He didn't say if the world, he said if my people. If my people who are called by my name, I'm telling you, revival's not just going to fall out of the sky, folks. The power of revival and the anointing that God wants to bring is not just going to fall out of the sky one day and we're just going to meet with it and everything's going to be okay. It's going to come through some tears. It's going to come through some praying. It's going to come through some people getting alone in their closet. It's going to come through some fasting. It's going to come when, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and then will I heal their land. I'm telling you that God is getting ready to heal his land when his people who are called by his name will humble themselves and pray. Church was designed as a place of refuge where people come in and they were safe. It's designed to be a place to where people come in and they are helped. It's designed where those who need deliverance can be delivered. It's designed to be a place to where the power and the Spirit of God can break every yoke, destroy every yoke, and lift every burden off of people's lives. It's not a place of where you're supposed to come in and nitpick everything that you think.
think is wrong and talk about it and talk it down, but it's where you come in and join together as the body of Christ to see the anointing of God released over a house, to where the captive can be set free, to where the power of God can work miracles and might, and the power of God move in people's heart and people's lives. Hallelujah. To be a body, and if we're gonna be the body of Christ, how many of you, the Jesus went to heaven, but the Christ stayed on earth? That means the anointed and his anointed, his anointing is still here on earth, and we are the body. Let's act like the body. He has given us gifts. Let's let the power and the anointing of the Spirit of God flow through our hearts and lives. Come on, somebody. Stop looking at everything that's not good and start looking at everything that is good. There's a lot of things that ain't right in the church today, but there's a lot of things that are right. You better praise God that you've got a pastor who will stand up and defend you and stand for you and equip you with the sword of the Spirit, who will pray for you. Come on now. You better be thankful that you got people who will volunteer their time to get here early to worship and to praise the Lord, to set an atmosphere to where people can be healed and set free by the glory of God. Hallelujah. Be thankful that you got somebody that will take time during the week that will come to church and pray. You don't know what's going on behind the scenes. You don't know the hell that people go through to get here on Sunday morning, to make everything, to set an atmosphere up to where the presence of God can flow. So that when people come in, things happen. Where people can be delivered and set free. Solomon prayed a prayer. And when the people pray, that the prayer that they pray would be heard. Your prayer's heard. Your prayer touches heaven. Solomon had no idea of what he was praying at that time. He didn't know the trouble that Israel was going to go through. Folks, I'm worried about the church. I'm concerned about the church. Because we've got off track. We've lost the power. You say, but no, we ain't lost the power. Yeah, we have. We've watered it down. We want to make people feel comfortable. It's not about being comfortable. It's about being the powerful people of God that He designed us to be. He didn't put His Spirit in us so that we could be comfortable. He put His Spirit in us so that there could be gifts that would be released through us so that we could prophesy. But see, the problem here with prophesying is people are just saying things today. They're just saying things. They're not hearing God. They're just saying things. But when you begin to hear what God is saying and you declare those things, it is at that point that that will not return to you void. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn and turn and turn and turn and turn and turn from their wicked ways. We want to point fingers at somebody that's smoking cigarettes or drinking a beer or something like that, but we don't want to talk about nobody that's talking about somebody. I can tolerate somebody in the world drinking a beer a lot better than I can tolerate somebody in the church that's spewing off about somebody else. People out there don't know no better. People in here are supposed to know better. Come on now. We're people of God. You don't know how the devil's fighting. No. Don't be giving credit to the devil. People fighting among themselves. Devil ain't having to do much. We're doing a lot all by ourselves. If you got all against your brother, you don't go tell somebody else. March up to that man or you march up to that woman. Talk to them. That's scripture. Be a man. Be a woman. Talk to them. Why? Because there's going to come a day that you're going to need agreement with one another. Well, I don't get along with them because, and I didn't mean to get off on this, but we feel like we don't want to get along because our personalities don't match sometimes. It's not about your personality. We are all a part of the body of Christ, and we need to get together. We need to connect in some way, in some form. If not, we're going to miss out on what God has for us. If my people call by my name. Who are his people? You are. We are. We're his people. When the people of God, if you go to the book of Joel and you'll read the book of Joel, you'll find out that when the people of Israel began to repent and began to turn back to God, the grass got greener. The pastures were plush. Everything began to prosper. People in an area begin to repent, jobs come to that place. How many cities are we seeing all around the world right now that are shutting down jobs? Jobs are shutting down and they're moving. But I promise you, if those cities would repent, things would change. How do you know that? I know that because I know what the Lord spoke to me. The Lord spoke to me and told me, said, in my presence, everything will prosper. Before I ever left and went into evangelism, I was scared to death. I was shaking in my shoes. I did not know how I was going to make it. And the Lord spoke to me and said, in my presence, everything prospers. He said, if you'll step out, I'll take care of you. Get to the place in my life to where things are falling apart, I check myself. Am I in his presence? Because I'm going to prosper in his presence. If we repent, turn from our wicked ways, we'll hear from heaven. He'll heal our land. Some of you need presence of God to move desperately in your family. Some of you need it in your home. Some of you need it in your general lives. You've tried to overcome things and tried to overcome things and you've not been able to do it. Let me just tell you this. You alone will never be able to do it. You'll never be good enough. Worth it all. And God made you worthy when the blood of Jesus Christ was applied to your life. When the blood of Jesus Christ was shed, He made you worth it all. And you have the ability to overcome through Christ Jesus. You can't make excuse. Everybody in this room has the same ability to overcome. They have the same. You say, well, I don't have the opportunity. Yes, you do. If you're under the sound of my voice tonight and you're in this room, you have the ability. You have the ability to have everything that Christ has for you. Because you're here, you have the opportunity tonight to turn things around. Tonight could be the night that you draw the line in the sand and say, enough is enough. It stops here. I'm not putting up with it anymore. And you go forward. Everything that God has moves forward. He's not going to drag you backwards. He's always going to take you further. Amen. Let's all stand. Obey the Spirit. Come on, somebody give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. See people begin to rise up and begin to pray, and as they begin to pray, I begin to see lights come on in the midst. midst of that darkness. Darkness can never overcome light. It will never, never, never overcome light. People, that is the reason that we must join together. We must come together. Together, it dispels the darkness. And I just believe with it, all the darkness to go. See, we want the darkness to go. We want everything to be fine, and we want everything to be back the way it was and all that. It's not going to be. You say, well, we're gonna do this and we're gonna do that. Listen, folks, we're at the end of the end. Church, you got to get in or get out. Don't be lukewarm. Be filled with the Spirit. You don't need to be filled with wine. You need the new wine. You don't need intoxicating drink. I promise you, the Holy Spirit can make you drunk. Got to come together, folks, we're the church. We're not a church, we are the church. And it's time that we walk in the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. I want everyone who will, I want you to come together around these altars. Say this. There's somebody here tonight. You need to make things right with God. You need to turn everything over to the Lord. Don't you leave here. Listen to me. Don't you leave here with what you came in here with. If you do, it's going to be devastation and destruction. Thank you. mighty things. You're making things right with God. You don't worry about what nobody says about you. I learned a long time ago, I'm not worried about what anybody says about me or what anybody thinks about me. I'm worried about pleasing one man.
Bind her no more.
name of Jesus. Enemy has done everything he could do and thrown everything that he could throw at this house to try to stop and try to keep it doing for what God has called it to do. But I decree and declare to you that it's going to go forth with might. It's going to go forth with power. It's going to go forth with new anointing, with fresh power. Come on, somebody needs to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God is going to turn around for your good. Hallelujah. You got to get your minds, get off of people, and get your mind set on God. It is God that's leading you, and it is God that is directing you, and it is God that's going to deliver you. It's going to be God that sets the captives free. Hallelujah. Multitudes of people will march into this place and be set free because of the power and the glory of God that is set in this house. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Father.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus right now, we praise you, Lord God. We thank you, Father. Come on, somebody praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I feel anointing of the Holy Ghost in this place. I feel the power of the Holy Ghost in this place. Hallelujah. Get up and move forward. You've wallowed in this long enough. Strength and anointing God's placed on you. Is the enemy going to come against you? You better bet he's going to come against you. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Have you been knocked down? Yes, you've been knocked down. But get up and go forward, because the power and the anointing of the Spirit of God is on you. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, raise your hands. Hallelujah. Jesus, yes, Lord Jesus, yes, Lord Jesus. Father, we praise you. We praise you right now, Lord Jesus. We glorify your holy name, Lord God. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Is it okay if we just have a cleansing in this place tonight? I want to encourage you. If you've got some kind of ought against somebody, you need to lay that thing down.
Hallelujah.
We praise you. Now somebody just rejoice and begin to give him praise for it. Hallelujah.